I was researching, as I have mentioned beforehand, I'm looking into the early years of the church and wondering where everything went wrong, basically. But I found this quote, and I searched it up, and I found this web page, and I thought it was interesting, so I'm going to read from it. The quote was concerning the Jews. They actually put this, they incorporated this anathema, this curse, in the synagogue, in the liturgy. So they had to say this, and this kept some of the Jews from being there. And I just thought it was interesting that they even went to the point of having to say this. So the quote is, "May the Nazareans and the heretics be suddenly destroyed and removed from the book of life." And, Jesus was of Nazareth. He was known as a Nazarene. And, any of the early Jews who accepted Jesus as the Messiah would have been Nazarene Jews. And here they are, saying that you have to say this in the synagogue. So they would have to pronounce a curse on themselves. Obviously, they wouldn't want to do that. But I'm going to get into this article, which is actually just a question and an answer. Most of it is the answer, but I'll start with the question. And I hope you enjoy this. This was posted on March 15th, 2011. The question is, when did the church stop being Jewish? When and how did the church lose its original identity as a Jewish religious sect? This is a question that attracts more and more attention from Christians, but the answers are often wrong or misleading. The essential question is this: what happened to the Jewish followers of Jesus and their congregations? They wrote almost all the books of the New Testament, except for Luke and Acts. They planted all the first congregations. Where did they go and why did they disappear? Recently, a pastor who was a friend of mine sent me this quote. One of his elders had used it during a Bible study in order to explain why the Jewish followers of Jesus faded out of church history. Quote, "Although persecuted by the Jews, 1 Thessalonians 2:14, the Christians in Palestine long remained a group within Judaism. But the break became inevitable. A sentence in Suetonius's Life of Claudius could mean that as early as 50 AD, rioting between Jews and Christians had broken out in Rome. In Judea, the Jewish Christians kept the bridges open as long as they could, but they were severely harried, and about 85, to make sure of their exclusion, a formal anathema was incorporated in the synagogue liturgy. May the Nazareans and the heretics be suddenly destroyed and removed from the Book of Life." Owen Chadwick, The Early Christian Church, Penguin, 1967, page 20. My friend wanted to know if the facts were correct and if the imposition of this formal anathema actually was a marker signifying the inevitable end of a Jewish presence in the church. Here's my answer expanded for this space. Thanks so much for your note. I appreciate that you are wrestling with this important issue of the separation of the church from its Jewish roots. Your elder used a credible source of information, but I think the information is misleading, if not completely wrong. And here's the problem. There is a common assumption that the original Jewish believers in Yeshua died out and no other Jews wanted to follow Jesus. But the facts are otherwise. Historically, the Jewish believers in Yeshua disappeared because they were disowned and disinherited by the Gentile Christians, who were instructed by Paul to honor them as a remnant chosen by grace. Romans 11:5. Of course, the church so twisted this instruction by Paul, they eventually taught that Romans 11 had nothing to do with the Jews, even though it promises the future salvation of all Israel. The problem with the quote from Chadwick is that he begins with the commonly held assumption that Judaism and Christianity were already fixed as divided cultures. In fact, Judaism and Christianity were both very fluid in the first few centuries after Yeshua's death and resurrection. They had many different forms and were not so hierarchical, nor did they answer to many authorities. Consider all the early heresies that existed during the first centuries of Christianity. From Marcion rejecting the Jewish Bible as scripture to Arius denying the divine nature of Yeshua, that would have completely transformed the nature of our faith. Of course, Arius believed that Yeshua existed before everything else. He believed he pre-existed, which I don't. And so I believe this person probably thinks that Yeshua is God, and that would be wrong. But let me get back to the article. All right. Judaism was equally fluid during the same period, and a single proscription from the synagogue doesn't explain the full scope of historical events or attitudes of that period. Besides, why would a wide-ranging number of communities of Jewish followers of Yeshua spread through ancient Palestine and North Africa give up their identity? I have seen credible estimates that somewhere between 15 to 20% of all Jewish people in the first century after Yeshua became believers. They had their own congregations. In fact, their communities continued throughout the Holy Land region for centuries after 85 CE. According to the highly respected historian Eusebius, there was a tradition of Jewish leaders of the church in Jerusalem until 132 CE, when all Jews, including Jewish followers of Yeshua, were expelled from the city by the Romans. After the destruction of the temple in 70 CE, Judaism was transformed by the Jewish leadership in order to survive the loss of the sacrificial system. During this time, they were also fighting to resist the theological influence of the Minim, who were one of the few Jewish groups to survive after the temple's destruction, an event which Yeshua had predicted. The term Minim refers to Jewish believers in Yeshua and means, in Hebrew, believers, although Jewish authorities regularly translate the term in this context to mean heretics. Meanwhile, the communities of Jewish believers in Yeshua continued to thrive. One of the leading Messianic Jewish authorities on this issue, my late mentor and former professor of systematic theology at Wycliffe College, Toronto, Jacob Joez, points out that the insertion of the curse on the Minim into the liturgy of the 18 benedictions around 90 CE is probably an indication of a new surge in the growth of the Messianic community after the fall of the temple. See The Jewish People and Jesus Christ, Baker, 1949, page 55. In other words, Chadwick's proof of a diminishing or disappearing Jewish believing community is considered by other historians as a sign of its resurgence. The key turning point comes in 132 CE, when all the Jewish communities in the region of Palestina rose up to resist the newly imposed laws of the Emperor Hadrian, who, among other things, wanted to outlaw circumcision, a horrific act of mutilation from the Roman perspective. The uprising was widely joined by the Minim communities, but then the spiritual head of the revolt, 132 to 135 CE, Rabbi Akiva, declared their military leader, Bar Kochba, to be the Messiah. At this point, the Minim, who gave their messianic allegiance only to Yeshua, left the fight. I found that last paragraph interesting because it might suggest that the Nazarenes, the Minim, were still circumcising, perhaps. So I find that really interesting and probably in need of a study on that one. But I'll continue on here. After the revolt failed, the devastation among the Jewish communities throughout the region was horrific. Hadrian had most of the Jewish population sold into slavery or exiled, as well as destroying what was left of the temple and sowing Jerusalem with salt. However, as Arnold Rochenbaum points out in his book, Hebrew Christianity, Its Theology, History, and Philosophy, Baker, 1974, page 46, the book is now outdated, but the history is useful here, the communities of Minim persisted throughout the region until the Arab conquest in the mid-7th century. In fact, the original father of church history, Hegesippus, born circa 140 CE, is a member of that community. His five-volume work has been lost, but he is quoted extensively by another famous member of the Minim community, Eusebius. There continue to be prominent church leaders from among the Minim, including Epiphanius, bishop of Constantinople, even into the time of Constantine. So, if the Jewish believers persisted, why did they eventually disappear? Apart from the rise of Islam, which swept before it all other religious groups, why didn't they integrate into the larger Christian culture with other ethnic Christian communities? It has nothing to do with their exclusion from the synagogue. The real reason was the onerous racial prejudices of the early church fathers, who deliberately chose to purge all evidence of Jewish roots from Christian theology. Consider the declarations of the Council of Nicaea, 325. We ought not to have anything in common with the Jews. We desire, dearest brethren, to separate ourselves from the detestable company of the Jews. A major focus at that council was to separate forever the celebration of Easter from the timing of Passover. By the 5th century, successive acts by church councils led ultimately to the declaration of all Jews as second-class citizens in every Christian community. Until the Enlightenment, Muslim treatment of the Jews was often considered relatively enlightened by comparison with Christianity. The source of these calumnies can be placed at the feet of the church fathers, who fixed in Christian theology the perspective of Jews as Christ killers. Gregory of Nyssa, 331-396 CE, calls my people slayers of the Lord, murderers of the prophets, enemies of God. Nevertheless, many Christians tried to maintain contact with their Jewish roots. They may have read Paul's letter to the Romans and thought to do what he instructed, not to be arrogant, 11:20, but instead recognizing that the Jewish people are still loved by God, 11:28. In Antioch, the local church had sympathetic ties with the Jewish community, attending Jewish festivals and praying with them during the Sabbath. Some think the local body included Jewish believers. It's a matter of discussion. But then a new pastor arrived, a monk, called John Chrysostom, 347-407 CE, who was later the Archbishop of Constantinople. He castigated the congregation for their behavior. Famous for his preaching, his name means golden mouth, he denounced the synagogue as a place of prostitution and a house of idolatry. He declared the Jews live for their bellies. In shamelessness and greed, they surpass even pigs and goats. You should turn away from them as the pest and plague of the human race. Those ancient sermons, in popular circulation for centuries, remain the basis of a continuing church bias against Jews as inherently evil. It is this inhospitable climate that destroyed the relations between the church and the synagogue, and devastated the relations between Jewish and Gentile followers of Yeshua, even as the church literally outlawed any continuing spiritual contact of Jews and Christians, forbidding shared worship on the Jewish Sabbath, and definitely not at Passover, councils of Antioch, 341 CE, and Laodicea, 434 CE. Finally, these councils declared as heretical the remnants of the Messianic Jewish congregations in North Africa, often called Ebionites, which included the last remaining members of Yeshua's own family. See Oliver Melnick's book, They Have Conspired Against You, Responding to the New Antisemitism, 2007. Much of our own perspective on this issue is so tainted by these old, ingrained prejudices that we don't even recognize them. This is a point emphasized by my friend Daniel Gruber, author of The Separation of Church and Faith, Copernicus and the Jews, Elijah, 2005. He asks, why do our Bibles not translate the word Christ in the New Testament? What is a Christ? Many people think it is the last name of Jesus. Christians know it is a title, but there is no content to it, except as the Greek translation of a Jewish term, Messiah. We don't translate it Messiah because the term points to us as Christians. But more important, the term Messiah inherently suggests Yeshua's Jewish identity, so it is rarely used. Gruber asks more pointedly, name a major creed which refers to Jesus as a Jew or as the Jewish Messiah. I'll leave a link also to my FAQ playlist talking about Yahweh's Messiah, as there were many Messiahs in the Bible, and that is true. Many Christians don't even know what a Messiah is. Continuing on in this article. The original New Covenant congregations began as Jews who followed the Holy Spirit in reaching out to Gentiles, but the Greek and Roman cultures were very anti-Semitic. They thought that the God of Israel wasn't invisible, only ugly. They certainly couldn't understand the Jewish dislike of pork. Their visions of heaven had pigs literally jumping into roasting skewers, and I've already mentioned their view of circumcision. Within a few generations, this cultural divide led the early church fathers to deny the Jewish origins of the gospel and then erase them with disdain. Paul tried to get the early churches to understand that the unity of Jews and Gentiles was evidence of Messiah's transformative power. In Ephesians 3:4-6, he states that the mystery of Messiah is revealed by the Spirit of God uniting Jews and Gentiles in the body of Messiah, for the positive attitudes he worked so hard to promote, particularly in Romans 9, to 11 were subverted. A new awareness of the mystery has revived with the rise of Messianic Jewish communities across the globe. Flat Earth. Okay. But it's still hidden from many Christians who have had no knowledge of our significant growing Messianic community, particularly in Israel. To summarize, it was not historically inevitable for Jewish believers in Yeshua to disappear from the ranks of the larger body of Messiah. There may well have been a large gap between Jewish and Gentile cultures and between the Jewish and Gentile followers of Yeshua. But one single proscription from the Jewish community did not determine the fate of the Jewish followers of Messiah, nor did it justify the negative attitudes towards the Jewish people which appeared in successive church councils. But as those Christian attitudes were ingrained over the centuries, the very idea of a Jew believing in Jesus became as peculiar to Gentile Christians, who worshipped the Jewish Messiah, as it was to Jews. As I discussed fairly recently, the early church leaders and the Council of Nicaea, the book I'm reading, When Jesus Became God, you know, the churches in the 300 AD range, it was already wrong, basically. It was already heretical. So it's not surprising that they used these councils to, you know, separate the Jews from the Christians, because it was already becoming, they already believed that Jesus was pre-existent. That's not compatible with what the Bible teaches. It's not compatible with what the Jewish believers believed. Jesus was not pre-existing. He was a Messiah. He was God's Messiah that God said he was going to raise up. It's just sad and ridiculous to think. Let's think about what happened to our faith. You know? Anyway, hope you found this interesting. Thanks for listening. Have a blessed day.